Thank you very much for being here this evening. I'm Carol Ware, a member of the League of Women Voters chapter, which covers Brooklyn Park, Osseo, Maple Grove, and Brooklyn Center. It is customary to assign members to moderate forums in districts other than the one in which they vote. The candidates participating in today's forum have all agreed to the voters' forum rules as included in their invitation to participate. Forum policies pertaining to the audience are provided on the inside left page of this evening's program. The League of Women Voters does not endorse candidates. All views expressed will be those of the individual candidates and not the League of Women Voters. Each candidate will give a 2-minute introductory statement and a 2-minute closing statement. The candidates will have 1 minute to answer questions. A timer will signal them when they have 30 seconds remaining and when their time is up. We will accept written questions throughout the forum. Questions submitted by the audience must not be personal in nature and must be on topics relevant for state office. All questions must be addressed to all candidates. Raise your hand when you have a question, and an usher will pick up your, or I guess you don't have to raise your hand, just pass your question to your right, and then an usher will pick up your question and will bring it up to me, and I'll be asking the questions. They will be checked before they are brought up so that if there are several questions on the same topic, they can be consolidated, or if there's something not clear, they can be clarified before we ask them. Please remain as quiet as possible so that everybody may hear, and hold your applause until the forum has ended so that candidates will have as much time as possible to answer your questions. And right now, I'd like all of you to please check your cell phones and be sure that your cell phone is on silent so that it doesn't go off during the forum. This evening's forum is for the candidates running for office in Senate District 64. They are seated in alphabetical order. We welcome Ian Baird and Dick Cohen for State Senate, Emery Dively for State Representative in 64B, Riley Horan and Aaron Murphy for 64A, and Dave Pinto for 64B. Again, thank you so much for joining us this evening. Enjoy getting acquainted or gaining further insight into the SD64 candidates' views on public policy. Now we will begin with the introductory statements of the candidates, and they will each have 2 minutes. We will start in alphabetical order, and then for the closing statements, we'll go in reverse alphabetical order. Would you like to start, Ian Baird?
Thank you to everybody for coming out. It's nice to see that we have a really great crowd out here today. Thanks to the League of Women Voters for hosting this and putting this on. I decided to get into this race because I looked at the options that we had, and I said we can do better options, and we need to branch out and look at some of the different stuff that's happening. Some of the big issues that I want to address is I believe we have way too much bureaucracy in our state government, especially to look at issues like the Metropolitan Council, which has kind of taken over the lead on transportation and making all of those decisions for us. Education, we need to close the education gap, and I think that's something that everybody here would agree with. I think that we can do that a lot by providing for school choice for all students and parents, and by merit-based hiring for teachers. And I believe we also need to deal with the cost of doing business in Minnesota, the tax structure that is very hard on small businesses. Something that is very correlated with that is the issues going on with MnSure. Most of you probably saw that the costs of individual coverage for MnSure is slated to go up to 67%. Which is really drastic. So that's kind of why I'm here, and I look forward to talking to you throughout the evening. Thank you.
Thank you. As Ian mentioned, thanks to the league, to Mary and Carol for the work you're doing. Appreciate everybody showing up tonight. Let me offer a couple of comments. I've had a chance to talk briefly to both Ian and Riley this evening, who I had not met before. Emery and I know each other from the last X number of years. So let me just offer a couple of perspectives on my candidacy and my seeking re-election as the senator from this district. Principally at the legislature, I serve as chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, have had that position for a number of years. And so I kind of start from that basis. And I realize this sounds a little bit wonkish as opposed to some of the issues get a little bit more attention. But government, whether you're conservative or liberal, begins and ends with the state budget. If you're for cutting spending, you're for increasing spending, you're dealing with the state budget. And one of the things I take some pride in the last couple of go-arounds is that in the aftermath of the deficits that we had in the latter part of the first decade, we finally have been able to establish in the last several years, Governor Dayton's led the way, with a structurally balanced budget. That sounds like something out of a poli-sci book somewhere. But without having a budget that, again, is structurally balanced, that's how you start to fall into deficits. I'm particularly proud this past couple of years, Senator Rod Scoy and I came up with the idea to take a third of the surplus and put it into the budget reserve so that the next time around, when we have an economic downturn, we're not slashing budgets. So if reelected, my intent would be to continue to make sure we have a structurally balanced budget, not only for this next biennium, but for the biennium subsequent to that. That's how you make sure the state has fiscal stability.
Hello, my name is Emery Dively, and I want to thank the League of Women Voters for providing the interpreter so that I can have communication access here. This is a wonderful opportunity for the democratic process. And this is not my first time running. Actually, this is my third time. Some of you may be wondering, why the third time? I really believe in this process, in public policy, and helping the community. Some of the specific issues that I want to look at would be, you know, in urban communities, we usually have a single party. We have the DFL right now, and what's happening in legislation is, we have these two worlds, and everyone's kind of competing. And I think that we should really focus on having a Republican representation in urban communities so that they can serve both perspectives, and we can work together as bipartisans rather than being separate. This is Minnesota. You know, 64B is the largest, has the largest population of Republican voters, and I'm looking at this as an opportunity rather than continuing to go back and forth and struggle like we have been. For example, with the roads and public transportation, people always go back and forth on what to do, but Minnesota, all of Minnesota's roads, you know, we need transportation in all the areas. That's one of our big needs. We need a Republican representative there to get the urban view. And that's just one example. So another one would be special education in public schools. We need to strengthen our schools, the education, and add an emphasis and a focus on special education. I think we've always been lagging behind in that because no one wants to fund it or support it, or they just do, you know, it's very minimal. Minnesota has a good reputation, however, we do also have a long way to go.
Thank you, and thank you to the League of Women Voters and the Highland Park Community Center for hosting this forum tonight. I would also like to thank all my friends for coming out and supporting me tonight. It means the world to me. And I would also like to thank Representative Murphy for joining me tonight. It's an honor to be here with you. I was born and raised in Northern California. I've been around in Minnesota here for 3 years, and it's just gone above and beyond any expectations I've had coming in. I'm the oldest of 5 siblings, and I'm convinced that the best job I'll ever have is being an older brother. I want to talk to you all just right at the beginning here about values. I think it's really important as candidates that we all make to our voters very clear what our values are so that voters know what to expect from us when we're elected. I will tell you all, I stand firmly upon three values: faith, family, and freedom. I believe in the unifying power of faith to fix broken communities. Minnesota, there is a great divide between Democrats and Republicans, the African American community, and police officers. That's something that needs to be addressed. And I believe that faith and spreading the word and the unifying power of faith can fix those problems. I believe in family. I believe that the American family is the bedrock of this country and the bedrock of this great state. We need to tailor our policies around making life easier for families and especially for kids to succeed in school. Lastly, I stand upon the value of freedom. I believe that our freedoms are not granted to us by any state legislature, by the federal government. Rather, our freedoms are granted to us by God and written in our Constitution. And that is something that if I'm elected, I will work every day to preserve. I thank you all for being here, and I look forward to sharing my ideas with you.
Thank you. Thank you very much to the League, and thank you to everybody for being here. And I also want to thank Riley for being here as well. Nice job on that first statement. I am so happy to be here tonight. I am a registered nurse. I have lived here in this district now since 1988. And I was a person who was never ever going to run for office, but at the end of my mom's life when I was taking care of her, and after many, many years of working to assure health care coverage for people, I learned, just like many other Minnesota families learn, that even with good coverage, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get the treatment you need for yourself or for your loved one. That was a transforming experience for me, and it was the reason why I decided to run. I came back home from my mom's funeral, talked to my family, and got into a race 10 years ago, and was lucky to earn the support of the people of 64A. And I will tell you, it has been my great honor to represent the people of this district, to work together to try and build the future for Minnesota. This afternoon, I was in a classroom with a couple of people who live in the district I represent, and we were with their election club talking about this upcoming election. I was with 40 volunteers, 9th through 12th grade, and we had a 45-minute discussion that was the best of what I think is our politics. I believe in a politics to improve people's lives, and every day in my job, I see the possibility of doing that. And with those young people today, Democrats and Republicans, people coming from different points of view, we had a solid, positive discussion about the future of Minnesota. And it is the kind of thing that Minnesotans are aching for as we work together to think through the hard problems we face. And I'm going to continue to do that work and join them as I work to earn your vote to serve again in the Minnesota House of Representatives. Thank you.
Dave Pinto.
Thank you to the League. Thanks to my fellow candidates for being here, and all of you as well for being here. So I'm in my first term representing 64B in the House. It's Highland Park, McAllister, Groveland, and Fort Road West 7th area, but I'm not new to the area, so spent a lot of time in this room as a member of the Highland District Council, one of our sponsors of the event here. My wife, Abby, and I have two boys, a 5th grader in Expo Elementary and a 7th grader at Highland Park Middle, and I'm a prosecutor. I work for the Ramsey County Attorney's Office, specializing in sexual violence, domestic violence, and gender violence more generally. I am the director of statewide training and protocol development, until recently was, for the Safe Harbor System, which many folks in the room may have heard of, trying to prevent the exploitation of kids. And that's a real driver for my work, for why I wanted to run for the State House and the work that I've done. I'm really proud of my first term. I was named a legislator of distinction by the League of Minnesota Cities. But there were a lot of missed opportunities as well, a lot of places where I could see that there's a lot more that we could do, having a transportation system that works, trying to avoid the over time, the real dollar cuts in support for our schools, action on climate change. There's so much we could go through. And the big issue for me is early childhood development, making sure that every child gets off to a great start. Given time, every other challenge we can think of goes away if we can have that work, if we can unlock the power in every child. I am running to turn the corner on that, to help to make sure that that we can take advantage of those many opportunities that we have. And I'm looking forward to getting to talk more about the details of that tonight. So thanks again.
We will now go on to the question part of our forum. And the questions are all from the audience. You will have 1 minute to answer the questions. And for each question, I'll call on you in a different order. And this is a kind of randomized order. So you won't know exactly when you're going to be coming up. But I'll give a tip to the first person each time, so they can be sure to pay attention. For the first question, Dave Pinto will be the first candidate to answer the question. What is your plan for fixing the gridlock problem in the state's legislature?
Oh boy, this is so I came with high hopes. I mean, I have a background as a prosecutor. I have an MBA and a strong corporate background, and I think and certainly friends of both parties, and actually multiple parties as I think about it. So I really came in with very high hopes. I will say that in the early months of 2015, that was very exciting. There was a lot of good talk. Things seemed to be very good, and really made a shift that I saw in the House majority. A real sense that as we got closer to having actual budget targets come out, to actually make actual decisions about how the state's going to spend its money, what it's going to do, and we didn't see that. I'm certainly working hard to have a DFL majority I think that we've seen in the 2013-2014 session that when you have a DFL majority in the House, in the Senate, and a governor, that what we have is progress. And that's at least, I think in the short run, that's a piece that we're driving towards to deal with that gridlock.
Riley Horan.
I appreciate whoever asked that question. I think that's one of the biggest problems we have in state legislatures all across the country, and even in our United States government. I think it's clear to all of us that that is a huge problem. So, like I said, I was born and raised in California, and I was actually raised in the third most liberal county in all of America. So I've spent my fair share of time getting to know the values of the other side, and I have a great deal of respect for Democrats. At the end of this past legislative session, there was a budget bill that really should have been passed. I think they were given plenty enough time to work on it, and the fact that it wasn't passed, mainly due to the level of partisanship Governor Dayton showed to all of Minnesota, and I think that's very clear to us, it was not able to get passed. And we need our legislators and our governor all to work together to pass common sense reforms that don't just favor one party or another, but that favor the people of Minnesota.
Ian Baird.
The number one thing I'm gonna do is get elected. If you look at, it's really interesting, actually, when Dick Cohen was elected here in 1986, he took over the last Republican-held Senate seat. And if you look at you can look at the lines that are actually drawn, geographical, not just ideological lines, between parties and between ideologies. If we don't start to break down those geographical lines, then we're not going to be able to break down the ideological lines. Because what you can see is what's happening in the legislature right now is that rural interests have decidedly different interests than urban interests. But the rural interests are mostly, not entirely, but mostly run by Republicans. The urban areas are mostly controlled by Democrats.
Erin Murphy.
In my 10 years, we've had sessions where gridlock has really stopped us, as I experienced in these last 2 years, and other terms in which gridlock was way less evident, and we've made real progress for the people of Minnesota. I think that the election each 2 years really determines whether or not we're going to have a period of time where we can work together and make some progress, address the issues that are in front of us, or if we're going to come into the legislature with strong ideological perspectives that slow us down. I think that each of us who serve in the legislature have to remember that our job is to listen, to understand what the problem is and work to solve that problem. We have to build relationships and learn to trust one another, and that goes for Democrats and Republicans, and Democrats and Democrats and Republicans and Republicans. But we also have to remember that the candidates who come in, their perspectives, how they want to serve, makes a significant difference. And so who we elect is critical to whether or not there'll be gridlock.
Emery Dively.
Well, I believe that there are really three issues that have caused these problems between the Democrats and Republicans. It has to do with the rural and urban divide and whether or not people want to be more liberal or conservative with how they deal with the budget. And I don't think there's been enough representative for Republicans in the urban area. And that's one feeling I feel strongly about. We need to have more of that. If you think that we're going to just solve it by having all Democrats, I think we're not really representing all the people of the state. And I think we need to have a healthy balance of, you know, maybe instead of a blue area versus red, we'll make it purple. But you know, we need to have some urban Republicans and some rural Democrats, and then I think we can have a balance and we can really discuss how the budget's going to work. And I think that's how we get a stronger Minnesota, because Minnesota's always kind of waved back and forth. We've never been more one than the other, but it feels like there's such a divide between the urban and the rural area that's really been the problem. So I think that would help to have more Republicans in the urban area represented.
Dick Cohen.
A couple of thoughts. I think I would agree with both Emery, with Ian, who talked about some of the geographic divides. But I think it's also a question of personality. I'm proud of the fact that during this past year's session, with all the talk of gridlock, there was one major bill that was passed and signed into law by the governor, and that was my supplemental finance bill. And we worked hard on that. The conference committee was chaired by myself, obviously, and my counterpart from the House, Jim Knobloch from St. Cloud. Jim and I are leagues apart ideologically, but we figured out how to get it done. And I've been able to do that in the legislature. So I think it's a question of being able to just try to figure out what the common ground is. My first stint as finance chairman, the Republican counterpart in the committee was a fellow named Denny Fredrickson from New Ulm. And he was the senior Republican in the Senate, the senior member of the finance committee. Dennis and I would sit down throughout the session to work on what needed to be done, and we accomplished it. So I think part of it is making sure that you have folks who can work together. I think I've demonstrated that. I certainly was able to do so this year, but also just mention that the finance bill got a very strong bipartisan vote in both the Senate and the House.
Answer it. What do you believe the biggest issues facing your districts will be in 2017?
So the three main issues I see is passing the budget bill that never got passed, that would have cut taxes for every single Minnesotan. And I think that's very important that both Democrats and Republicans come together on that. I know that'll be challenging. Education is another big thing for me. Like I said, I'm in college, and I think it's important that we really start funding school choice programs that allow parents and teachers to decide what's best for students rather than the state government. And lastly, I think investing in our roads and bridges, our infrastructure in Minnesota, is important rather than funding mass transit, which only serves a very small minority of people. I think we need to focus on roads and bridges, which is 98% of the people in Minnesota drive to work, drive to get from point A to point B, and I think it's important that we take care of the 98% of people. Yeah.
Dave Pinto.
Well, the top issue for the state, in my mind, for all of us, as I said before, is early childhood development, making sure that every single child gets off to a great start. So there's all these disparities. I think we're aware, many of us, that our state has, while we have some great outcomes and all sorts of different measures, we have some of the biggest disparities between people of color and other Minnesotans. Those disparities don't just start in the criminal justice system or in education or in economics or in healthcare, though they're all there. They start right at the very beginning of life, even with prenatal care and beyond. As I said before, if given time, everything else that we can think of, any other challenge that we can think of, can be dealt with if we can simply unlock the potential inside of each child. So I'm focusing a lot on this. Just this morning, I hosted the second in a series of policy forums, prenatal to three policy forums, bringing advocates together who are working on these issues to develop an agenda for 2017 and really for beyond, to make sure that our state is a leader in the country on dealing with this, and again, then dealing with pretty much anything else we can think of.
Ian Baird.
Yeah, that's a really tough one just because there are so many issues to pick from. I think I have to say that the issues that we're seeing with MNsure right now, like I mentioned in my opening, we're seeing costs go up by an average of up to 67% for people buying on the individual market. The cost is going up. And it's making it really hard for people who, especially small businesses and people who are just trying to make a living on their own, to succeed. And I think that's a really big deal.
Dick Cohen.
A couple of the folks have mentioned transportation, and I just kind of parenthetically, so that people are not confused, I think Riley's talked about one of the important bills that did not pass. I believe you're referring to the tax bill. The budget bills I mentioned did pass, the supplemental finance bill. Transportation is the issue that has been left undone year after year. 2013, the Senate passed an omnibus transportation bill. 2015, we passed an omnibus transportation bill. 2016, the Senate passed an omnibus transportation bill. I would disagree with Riley to the extent that you need a transportation bill that does everything. You do need roads and bridges, but you also need transit. In fact, my law office is on the western end of University Avenue. It's across from the Raymond stop for the Green Line. I take that all the time now to court in Minneapolis or to St. Paul, and I see the folks who need transit. If we're going to grow Minnesota's economy and make sure that we have an economy for the next 50 years, we need a transportation bill. We need it passed now.
Question? I think you have 30 seconds to respond.
I was going to ask the audience, how many people took advantage of the light rail system today? I take the bus to get to work. I've tried out the light rail a handful of times. I take it during rush hour. No one rides the thing. You could find a seat anywhere you want in it. It's very, very underutilized. It shuts down. During construction, it shut down businesses on University Avenue that could have employed hundreds and hundreds of people.
I agree with Riley here. My roommate does public transportation every day. He thinks the light rail is stupid. He never takes it, and he's been doing public transportation for years. If you actually look into what the people who, like the Metropolitan Council and the people who are supporting these transit proposals, are saying, it's not so much about transportation as it is about distributing people throughout the suburbs and in the metropolitan areas.
Thank you. I think that we have to have an eye on our future. We finally have a budget that is balanced with a modest surplus, which gives us an opportunity to think about not just the next 2 years, but the next 10 and 20 years when we're going to see significant demographic change. We need to make sure that we're building an economy that works for everyone and so that everyone feels like they have a chance, a shot at opportunity here in Minnesota. So we need to continue to invest in education, early education, as my colleague Dave Pinto is talking about, K-12 education, and higher education to make sure that students aren't coming out of college with enormous debt, as they are. It's a real impediment to our future. We need to think through investing in our infrastructure. We didn't pass a bonding bill for the first time in 30 years in this last session because we ran out of time. We're neglecting our infrastructure in doing that. And last but not least, I think we need to look at campaign finance disclosure in a way that we will be able to protect our democracy and our voices and our vote. Thank you.
No clapping until the end. Thank you. Emery Dively.
Well, I think there are two important issues. Special education funding, full support for that. It's been a concern because, you know, they say they would help with special ed, but they're not, the school districts have really been doing everything they can to avoid, to minimize cost. The districts run their individual show rather than what parents want for their kids, and I think that's a really big issue and a concern, and I'd like to see that looked at more because we're talking about early childhood development and we're doing all that work, but we need to give more equal access. And the other thing is we need to work more on a job development bill that will help people be able to earn more money and not have to and pay the taxes instead of taking, you know, money from the state. I think it would be better to have money so that people can earn money and pay for the programs out there. If we don't look at jobs, we'll see the economy spiral down. We need to have a pro-employment bill. And I think once we fund all those different projects and things, the economy will continue to grow.
The next question, the first person to answer will be Dave Pinto. If elected, how would you work to address the racial disparities in St. Paul schools?
So the racial disparities in St. Paul schools, I guess that's probably getting at the achievement gap. And as I said, so that disparity we know is paralleled by disparities kind of all the way along the line. So we certainly need to be starting off at the beginning of life, making sure that to be lessening those disparities as well. Regarding, though, current kids, it doesn't help out current kids, right? We really need to have a whole set of wraparound services, recognizing that the disparities that we're seeing in schools in these kids' lives are reflected in disparities in economics, the income that their families have, what kind of housing that they're living in, and the kind of support that they receive. So there are schools, there are programs that have these wraparound services and support, recognizing the particular special needs that are out there. And so we really need to come at it from that kind of broad perspective. This is a whole broad spectrum approach, and it's not a silver bullet. It's not one particular approach, but we need to start by recognizing how critical it is for the success of our state in the long term.
Emery Dively.
Well, I agree that that is a great need, and Minnesota is a wonderful place, has many wonderful opportunities. We have so much, so many ethnic minorities here. You know, it's like the promised land. But we still have a lot more to do to help people get through school, get through jobs, get through the economy and society. And I think the key is investing in education and helping to support that. There are tough issues, yes. We've been working on them for a while. But Minnesota has such a great reputation of investment in people. Regardless of their background, their culture, their race, we invest in people, we invest in the individuals, and that's what makes Minnesota so special, and that's what makes us so proud. You know, it's a big-time investment. We make sure that this is a strong and healthy community, and we're a great role model.
Riley Horan.
I believe in the benefits of education. That's why I go to college, and I think that's why thousands and thousands of people across the country choose to invest in college. And to address the particularly where we're seeing the achievement gap in early education, I think teachers need to be hired and fired on the basis of merit rather than, excuse me, on the basis of performance rather than tenure. And that is something that I know my opponent and I disagree on, and I think it should be treated like any other job, where if you aren't performing the same as the other people around you, what's stopping someone from doing a better job coming in there and taking your place? I get that the Democrats and the DFL are looking out for the teachers union, but I think to fix the problems that exist, especially in urban schools, we need to be looking out for our students rather than the teachers union. The teachers work for the students, and it's not the other way around, and we need to support legislation that guarantees that that's the case.
Dick Cohen.
I would suggest that the achievement gap can't be simply answered by looking at one perspective. Three things. I've mentioned the supplemental finance bill this year. We provide money for racial inequities and disparities, first state in the country to do so. That was aimed more at employment growth. Second, as Dave has mentioned, early childhood is very critical to dealing with the achievement gap. And third, affordable housing. If you don't have a place to live, if you're homeless, if you can't find a place to live, you can bet the kids in that family are not going to be in a situation where they can learn. So if we're able to take what we've done this year with employment, see how that goes. We've started early childhood. We also have made some starts in terms of affordable housing. I think if you look at the achievement gap as that kind of a three-legged stool, we could make some real progress if we build on what we've done over the last several years.
Ian Baird.
Yeah, Dick's bill dealt with a symptom of the achievement gap, not anything with the achievement gap itself. I think that we need to look at school choice for every parent in Minnesota to have the option for school choice. And this is something that, if you saw recently, Rashad Turner, who was the head of Black Lives Matter in St. Paul for the past couple of years, recently resigned that position because of Black Lives Matter's position on school choice, and he believes that's a really huge issue. Also, as Riley mentioned, merit-based teacher security. I have a friend who has done substitute teaching in St. Paul inner city schools, and he told me some really heartbreaking stories about teachers who were just kind of milking the system because they'd gotten on tenure, and so that needs to stop.
Erin Murphy.
Thank you for the important question. I've spent a lot of time in classrooms and a lot of time with educators, and I have learned from them that the opportunity gap for young learners opens before they come to school. And that's why I think, like my colleague Dave Pinto, that we need to invest more in a very durable and ongoing commitment to early learning in Minnesota, including pre-K. But I also think that we have to think through the issue of inequity and disparities in education, in healthcare, and employment, especially for people of color, African Americans, and Latinos in the state of Minnesota. And until we're willing to acknowledge that those disparities actually exist and that we're contributing to them consciously or not, we're not going to really be able to rectify the issue that is driven by bias within us. And that's where we need to do the hard work as a state if everyone is going to meet their full potential and have a shot at a real opportunity in Minnesota.
Thank you. The next question, the first person to answer will be Ian Baird. How would you stimulate small business in Minnesota?
Well, the big thing we can do to stimulate small business in Minnesota is to reduce a lot of the tax burden that is put on small businesses. If we look at tax codes, there are a lot of loopholes that bigger businesses can get out of that small businesses don't have the resources to get out of. Another thing is dealing with MNsure, is a lot of smaller businesses have to buy their health insurance on the markets, and so we need to make the markets more affordable and set up that system for them. So it's really taking the cost of doing business in Minnesota, which is one of the highest in the nation actually, and reducing it to a more reasonable level.
Dave Pinto.
So I mentioned my background in corporate law and working with a number of businesses in the past. While it's true that we have perhaps a higher cost of doing business in some ways, we need to recognize, of course, we have had traditionally one of the strongest economies in the country as well. The reason for that is because of the quality of our workforce, the quality of our infrastructure in this state. And that, I think, is the best way to stimulate small business, to help business in the long run, to then help the economy and help all of us, is for the state government to have the infrastructure in place, to educate workers, to have a transportation system that works, that, yes, includes all modes of transportation and all options, to have a strong healthcare system in place, to have protection for the environment, for natural resources. All those things, having that context in place that state government can support, then that's the infrastructure within which great business people, entrepreneurs, will flourish, will take advantage of that. We need to make sure that we have that in place. And that does take resources, which traditionally our state has done, and we've seen the payoff from that through many decades.
Riley Horan.
I would just respectfully disagree with Representative Pinto's status of the economy. So our rate of new entrepreneurs is half of what the national average is, and that should be very concerning to those in legislature, because those entrepreneurs are the ones running these small businesses, and if they don't have a welcoming business environment, then they're not going to be able to hire people, and that's what we need. We need to give businesses all across the state of Minnesota a tax break, and just pull back on these regulations that businesses don't need. They already have enough. They already have enough work to do trying to get their business up and running. The last thing they need is the government getting in their way from letting them and those that they will hire succeed.
Aaron Murphy.
In my family, we earn our income from my husband's small business. He started that in St. Paul in 1980. And I will tell you the things that he talks most about in his frustration are a trained workforce, a properly trained workforce, and to make sure that there's consumer demand. And his company really struggled in the recession that began in 2008, because when people didn't have any money in their pocket and they felt insecure about their own economic security, they didn't purchase his services. They didn't purchase his goods, which impacted his company. So first and foremost, a strong economy is the best culture, the best medium for small businesses here in Minnesota. And then just so we're clear about the small market in healthcare, the rates were just released for the small market section of healthcare in Minshire, and they are primarily, in the majority, single-digit increases from -1, a decrease in rates, to single-digit increases. So the healthcare marketplace for small businesses is strong and functioning.
Emery Dively.
I believe that we need to strengthen our small businesses. I think, generally speaking, about we have about 80% of these large companies, and we're focusing on these big businesses, these big corporations that have special tax benefits and tax breaks. So we end up, you know, covering the costs of those taxes to help them, the big businesses in the big cities. So I think one thing we're overlooking is financial assistance for small businesses, and we can do that through lessening the taxes and making a bigger draw for training. And we can invest in more jobs and more hiring. From there, we can earn more taxes based on all of those new jobs. And the system typically favors bigger corporations. And, you know, things go back and forth between Minneapolis and St. Paul. And I think that's one thing that I believe in, having a healthy economy through small business, especially with insurance and taxes and regulations. I think we need to be small business friendly. And I think it would make the environment healthy and a better place to be.
Dick Cohen.
Two things. First of all, I would second what Aaron mentioned about a trained workforce. So there's the need, when you look at the demographics of Minnesota, what's going to happen over the next 20 to 30 years, we need to make sure the MinSCU system has the ability to train the workers that the employers are looking for. Second, Minnesota Investment Fund. When I've spoken to some of the business leaders in the state, they've talked about the difficulty that small businesses have getting access to startup capital. The investment fund, which had operated with success with Governor Dayton, with Governor Pawlenty, has had the ability to provide some of that capital on a supplemental basis that's allowed any number of small businesses to begin and flourish, leading down the road, in some cases, to some very larger businesses.
Can I respond quick to, actually, this is based largely off of what Dave said here. So what I heard you putting forward is actually more, it's the cost that you're still raising the cost of doing business when you're having all these programs put in place. And what we need for small businesses to succeed is we need to lower the cost of doing business. I have a small business myself. I work for a small business. I kind of understand what's going on here.
I guess if I can respond just briefly, I guess my point is that, yeah, so businesses are concerned, as all of us are, about lower costs. They're also concerned about the inputs to their business and about the infrastructure within which their business is happening. It doesn't do a lot of good if your costs are low if you don't have a trained workforce from which to draw from, or customers who can buy your products and services. So it's a combination of things.
I guess my point is that the bigger businesses can handle the higher costs more than the smaller businesses.
Question. Dave Pinto will be the first person to answer. With climate change becoming increasingly an urgent issue to address, what plans do you have in mind to combat climate change?
Well, so we have we've had recently some really nation-leading efforts that our state has undertaken, the renewable energy standard and a lot of energy efficiency work. Actually, Representative Murphy and I were just touring St. Thomas More, I think, was the church, right? Yeah, that had put in some energy-efficient lighting, and the payoff is coming for the lighting they put in within a year or two, actually, just in the work that they're doing. We've had a real stall on that the last 2 years. I mean, the first step to combating climate change is acknowledging that climate change is real. So there was a vote on the House floor, and the Republican majority voted, I think, pretty much unanimously, saying that it is not real and that not caused by human behavior, et cetera. So this is a real problem, obviously. So we've really had a stall in the past 2 years because of that kind of approach. So the first step to moving on this is recognizing that it's real, that it's going to affect everybody in the room. It's going to affect the younger folks in the room even more than other folks. And so we need to be taking action on it.
Ian Baird.
Well, I think that it's a false assumption to assume that government is going to be the answer to all of these problems. If we look at history and the history of our country, when big problems come up, it's American ingenuity that can solve them. And we look at Tesla Motor Company and what Elon Musk is doing with transportation, opening up something like American ingenuity and letting Americans just do what they do best, which is invent and innovate and come up with solutions to these complicated problems, is actually how we're going to be able to solve it.
Amory Dively.
Well, one thing about climate change is I understand there are a lot of concerns about that. And there are a lot of pressures to hurry up and, you know, in the short term to transfer over to different kind of energy sources, all forth. And I think we need time. And it's a process we go through. I feel like we're rushing because we feel like the end is coming so soon and we want to do this overnight. And that's what I think is causing a lot of the high costs and so forth. So I think it's going to take time, investment, and careful planning and thinking, and not to just try to, you know, twist our arms and get us to do this immediately. I mean, we have a beautiful state here in Minnesota and we really do cherish it, but we can't really tell other people in other states what to do. I mean, farmers have done a great job in this state. There's a lot of stress out there right now, and we have to think about the bottom line. And yes, I do think that climate change is coming, but I think the cost will be supported by our changes that we'll be taking in time.
Dick Cohen.
This evening, I hope I've not tried to be overly partisan, but I will in this instance. I'm not sure why the Republican Party simply denies climate change. Right now, as we speak, there's another major storm hitting the state of Florida, the second major storm in 3 weeks. That suggests that something's going on. And as a state, obviously, we don't have the ability to impact what's taking place throughout the world. But we need Minnesota to continue to participate in President Obama's Clean Power Plan. We need to provide appropriate support through the Department of Commerce, through tax credits for renewable energy sources, for making sure that citizens have the ability to make sure their homes are utilizing solar power, alternative sources of power. It's very striking that the businesses in Minnesota, like Xcel Energy, and I certainly have some disagreements with the utilities, but some of these utility companies are much further ahead than the state legislature has been in trying to make sure that we deal on an individual basis with climate change. But again, it's an international, it's a national problem, and Minnesota should make sure it supports those kinds of efforts.
Riley Horan.
So this has always been an interesting topic for me because first it was called global cooling, and then the name changed to global warming, and now we call it climate change. And I think that shows is there's data from there's data that suggests, you know what, the climate is changing, there are problems, and there's also data that says, you know what, the world's just fine, we're all going to be okay, we're all going to wake up tomorrow, and you know we're not going to be all gone. We can encourage people to invest in cleaner forms of energy, to drive hybrid cars, to drive electric cars, but the solutions of the DFL will only overregulate small businesses. It'll only make it harder for people to get hired. If you have, you're talking about a trained workforce, when you overregulate these businesses, they're not gonna have room to hire trained workers, so it's not gonna even matter if they're trained or not, if there's no room to even be hired. We need to pull back on regulations and let Minnesota's economy flourish.
Erin Murphy.
The consequences of ignoring climate change are significant for people across the globe, and the data is clear about that. People could lose their homes and their lives if we don't act. 10 years ago when I ran for the first time, energy and energy independence were significant issues in that election. And I was really proud in my first session to vote on that renewable energy standard. And in 10 years, we've seen real progress because we set policy and incentives to drive change in the marketplace. We're seeing investment in wind, in solar, and those are added to the grid. And the price of wind and solar is coming down in such a way that it is competing with fossil fuels. If we had not done that, the cost of producing energy with fossil fuels would have remained the cheapest form. We have to push ourselves to do it. We set a benchmark and goals. We shifted the incentives in the market. It is proof that together we can solve challenging, hard problems, and we already are.
The first person to answer the next question will be Dick Cohen. What is your stance on illegal immigration?
If the question is directed to me as a state legislator, obviously, if you're talking about immigration problems, border security, and so on, that's at a national level. I'm not sure we have a big problem with people coming over the border from Manitoba. But if it's a question of what to do with an immigrant community, I say we welcome an immigrant community. I've lived in Minnesota all my life with the exception of 4 years of college in Chicago, and I think the communities we've seen come into the state, the Hmong community, the Somali community, the Liberian community, we can go through the list, have added just a huge amount to the state. Now, obviously, any immigrant community needs support, as was the case in 1900, as was the case with my great-great-grandparents when they first came to the United States. You need support, you need community support. If it's a question of illegal immigration, I don't think that's a problem in the state of Minnesota. I'm not aware that it's been a problem for the state legislature.
Dave Pinto.
I get all the early ones here, I guess. So it's true. So immigration is a federal issue. We're really not even permitted really to get involved in most aspects of immigration. I too would just point out, I think first of all, the vast majority of people in this room, our families came to this country as immigrants. Our country has been benefited just enormously by immigrants in the, by immigration in the past and by immigration now and continuing into the future. It's been incredibly powerful. Incredibly powerful force, and we're really, really fortunate for that. So I think we need to be recognizing the benefits. There's been so much emphasis on the negative side of immigration, recognizing the benefits of it, but again, otherwise it really is more of a federal issue.
Erin Murphy.
I visited a school, a middle school in Minneapolis last year, Ramsey Middle School, and I met a student who had listened to a speech by Donald Trump and was concerned that if he were elected president, either she would be sent back to Somalia or her parents would be sent back to Somalia. It made it hard for her to learn, and she was really concerned about her place in Minnesota. I think that we have a lot of work to do to open our minds and open our hearts to the people that are coming to Minnesota from other places in the world, but we need to do it. In 2020, More people in Minnesota are going to be over the age of 65 than less. We need to make sure Minnesota is a welcoming place. So young people come here, they bring their good ideas, their innovation, and they work to build the future of the state. If we don't, a narrow population of people are going to be responsible for growing our economy and supporting a state budget. That's going to be a real difficult challenge for us. Minnesota has got to open its curtains, its doors, and welcome people in order to build our future.
Amory Dively.
Well, undocumented illegal immigrants, I guess I support those people who have come to this country legally. We have welcomed people from all over the world here, and Minnesota has had a great process of having people come in. And I don't like the idea that people cut the line illegally by coming. I don't like that, but it is a political situation that exists. And, you know, I'm not against immigrants. I encourage them to come. I think it just should be a respectful process. We're an open country. We enjoy having people come here. We take pride in being an immigrant country that welcomes people, and that people who are here, I think we should take care of them and so forth, but I think we need to support the legal immigrants that have come here and help them become U.S. citizens so that they can participate in the economy and vote in our communities. Thank you.
Riley Horan.
Illegal immigration might not necessarily be a Minnesota issue and an issue that our legislature discusses, but I still think it's very important that the question gets answered, and I do commend Representative Murphy for answering that, unlike her other two constituents in the Senate and House. I was in San Francisco the day Kate Steinle was shot and killed. I wasn't too far away from my where I was working at the time, and I think we need to make sure if an illegal immigrant is apprehended in our state, in any state in the country, that they are sent back to the place they came from. And, like I said, it might not be a Minnesota issue, but it's a question of judgment, and I think it's very important that us as candidates answer it, because it could be an issue in the future.
Baird.
It's something I think I agree with a lot of what Riley said, that, you know, if someone is here illegally, then, I mean, they're breaking the law. That's pretty simple, and they need to face the consequences of that. I mean, and that said, I do support immigrant communities that are here, and we have a lot of them in Minnesota. I mean, it's a great, great diversity of immigrants. And that's a really great thing, and I hope we can encourage that. But if they're breaking the law, well, they're breaking the law.
The The next question, Dick Cohen will be the first person to answer it. Do you have any specific proposals that would improve health care in Minnesota?
I'm going to defer a little bit to to Aaron, who's the healthcare expert at the table. Obviously, we've seen the significant proposed increases in the private individual market, and the legislature is going to have to address that. One of the things that might be of some help, I think a mistake the legislature made in the last several years, was to pass the repealer of the provider tax. I think it's very striking. When I talk to doctors today, as opposed to doctors when this passed in the 90s, a lot of the medical profession now likes the provider tax, understands that it's been a way to allow for growth in healthcare. And when you look at the problems we're going to have with the cost of healthcare and with making sure we keep healthcare affordable, I think one of the things we need to do is looking at the repeal of the repealer over the next couple of years.
Riley Horan.
Thank you for that question. It's very important. I'm sure we all saw the recent article in the paper on how the individual healthcare system is not doing so well in Minnesota. I think all Minnesotans should have access to a quality and affordable healthcare. And I think part of the problem is that our healthcare system is so complicated. And I think the first step is just simplifying the healthcare system in Minnesota. We need to empower patients. I don't think government should really has that much of a place in healthcare. I think it needs to be to the discretion of the patients, choosing their doctor, not letting government get in between them and their doctor. And I think we need to get rid of the state lines that exist. Why can't a citizen in Minnesota go to purchase healthcare in Iowa? It allows for a healthier marketplace, and it will drive down costs for Minnesotans. We saw in the paper that, like Ian said, healthcare costs are going to go up significantly. Obamacare has been a disaster for our country and for the state. Premiums have gone up. Obama promised that they would go down. It is a failed system, and it needs to be simplified and fixed.
Emery Dively.
Well, I thought that the economy we have here in Minnesota has always been a good system. And I kind of feel like instead of us looking to the federal government for their system, I think that they should take a look at us. And I think Minnesure's, you know, public option that they had, we put it out there and we thought that would take care of what the federal system wanted, and that we thought they would have good competition with it, and that it would be supported by taxes and so forth, and that, you know, private businesses would help support it with those tax. But it hasn't worked out the way that they have said it should be. I think what we really need to focus on is let the private business take care of it. They know how to take care of it. They know how to take care of the system and support it the way it needs to make the changes. And I think we need to have a bipartisan approach to solving this problem. I mean, there's an individual market out there, and we need to do something to make it more inexpensive. Right now, it's not going very well.
Dave Pinto.
So it's true that that healthcare is a really complicated system. There's a proposal. I'm supportive of a study of something called the Minnesota Health Plan. Ours is the only industrialized nation that doesn't have a single payer system. Not to say that that's necessarily going to turn out to be the right system, but something that we at least need to study. Because the concern right now is that, you know, these premiums that jumped up, those are for folks who bought on the individual market for a pretty small percentage of people, just I think it's 5% of Minnesotans. Other folks get their health coverage through their employer. And there's all this negotiation that goes on, and there's a lot of restrictions that are dependent on your employer, which shouldn't be necessarily that your health coverage is something that's necessarily tied to where you're working. There's really no logical reason that those two things should be connected. So there's all sorts of pieces that we can look at, prior authorization. Senator Cohen mentioned the provider tax, et cetera. But certainly exploring some possibilities to simplify things may certainly make some sense.
Aaron Murphy.
The Affordable Care Act built itself upon the current system of coverage, which straddles both public coverage and private coverage. And the issue that we're seeing today with the individual market is a result of private insurers wanting to shed risk. And rather than cover those lives, people who are sick, they decided to pull out of the market. That's a disappointment for me. In 2014, we passed legislation that created competitive bidding for school districts across the state of Minnesota. It created a comparison plan called PEEP, the Public Employee Insurance Plan, that would be a part of the bidding process. So a school district can go and get bids from Medica or Health Partners, but it has to have a bid from PEEP as well. And what we have learned through that process is that school districts are being able to negotiate better prices because they have a public comparison. I think that we should consider a public option on MinSure that people can choose from. So they can choose Health Partners or Medica or Blue Cross or Minnesota Care, and they can let their dollars drive their options. They'll get a better bargain, and so will Minnesota.
Ian Baird.
There are a few things that we can do. One is that people who are buying on MinSure right now only get the tax credits if they only buy on the exchange. And so if we remove that limitation and open up the marketplace that they don't need to just buy on that exchange, it's going to make a big difference. I also agree with Riley about removing the barriers between states with healthcare. You should be able to buy from Iowa or Wisconsin or wherever, like we do with car insurance, and that helps keep things more affordable for the insurance companies. So those are a few things, and this is a really desperately broken system, and we need to fix it. And I don't know that the people who have created the system that is desperately broken are the people we should put in charge to fix it.
We'll have one last question, and then we'll go to the closing statements. The first person to answer this last question is Dave Pinto.
I had my hand on my microphone already. It's true.
Do you support a bill that would allow felons to vote immediately upon release from prison, even if they are still on probation?
I certainly do. So I'm a prosecutor, so I've got a particular familiarity with this. Our state's prosecutors are supportive of this. A number of groups, faith groups and others, are supportive of this. Right now, somebody needs to be off of probation in order to be able to vote. This causes all kinds of challenges, just sort of administratively, all kinds of ways. But just more broadly, we want to make sure to have as many people be participating in our democracy as possible, recognizing that somebody, people get out of prison, they get done with probation, and we want them to be integrated and be a part of our society. To my mind, this is something that's a really critical switch for us to make, to be joining the majority of states where, in fact, this is the case. There are some states where even folks who are in custody can, in fact, vote. But for people who are out of prison, who are on probation, again, the county attorneys and others and law enforcement and many others around the state are supportive of this. So, yeah, I am as well.
Aaron Murphy.
Yes, I support the restoration of the vote for those who have served their time and are free from jail. There's real power in our vote. With our vote, we set our future, and everyone who is free in this country should have that opportunity to bring their voice and their vote to our future. So I absolutely support it. Yes, I do.
Riley Horan.
This isn't an issue I know a whole lot about. I've read into it a little bit, and I'm going to say no, we should not. We should keep the law as it is. Let these convicted felons finish their time, and then they can go become a voting member of society. And I think it's interesting that the DFL, they really talk about, we want to get as many to the people, that we want to allow as many people to vote as possible. And I would just like to get a response from them. When the DFL filed a lawsuit to take Donald Trump off the ballot, they sent a message to Minnesota saying, we want half the voters in Minnesota to stay home. And so when they talk about there's power in everyone's vote, I want to know how come the DFL rallied behind the head of the party when trying to
basically keep half the voters in Minnesota home.
I think that once somebody has served their time, they should be free to vote. But as far as I can see, when you're serving probation, you're still serving your time. So once that probation is done, then I support the right to vote after that has been restored.
Dick Cohen.
First, I would just mention to Riley, I disagreed with the DFL's motion to strike Donald Trump from the ballot. The extension of the right to suffrage has been, I think, one of the tremendous things about this country, whether it be women's suffrage, whether it be the folks who marched in Selma. There's been a history of the extension of the right to vote, to have that franchise. And I think the extension of felon voting rights is simply a matter of basic human decency and civil liberties. To suggest that people who have served their time should not have the ability to vote, as Dave Pinto put it, is just baseless when we're trying to get people back into society to make them feel like they belong, not that they're excluded.
Amory Dively.
I do support those in the restorative process, and those who are on probation due to the judge's sentence, however many years they had to serve and the years of probation. After that sentence is complete, they've paid the price. They've served their time, and then they should be allowed back into society as functioning members of society. And I think that if we give them permission to vote while they're still on probation, it's almost as if we're saying, well, you can do this halfway through your sentence. I think doing that would give a confusing message. We need something more clear. You committed a crime. Once your sentence is complete, jail time, probation, that's all complete. Once your sentence is done, you've served your time, then you should be a fully restored citizen and you should have your voting rights back. I support that.
Thank you.
Dick, thanks for standing against that, taking Donald Trump off the ballot. I really appreciate that. I would be curious to hear Aaron's thoughts on that, being the House Minority Leader and a real leader in the Democratic Party.
I didn't support that effort. I was not consulted about it when the party filed the motion, and I thought it was the wrong thing to do for Minnesota.
May I speak as well? And I wasn't consulted either. And I wasn't supportive of it either.
Thank you. So I think that's great that you guys didn't support it, but you guys have obviously built quite a following, especially Senator Cohen and Representative Murphy. So I'd be curious to know how come.
Sorry, Dave.
My apologies. And so.
Dave is the new kid on the block. So.
I'd just be curious, so if you were against it, how come you didn't publicly stand up against the leaders of your party if you were against something they were doing? It was an important issue. I know I made a statement on it. My question to you is how come you didn't do the same? How come you didn't stand up for half of Minnesota in responding to the leader of your party's lawsuit?
I wasn't aware of this. By happenstance, I was having a conversation with the party chairman that morning, and he mentioned to me, I said, are you sure? I mean, what is the point of this? And so to the extent that, now at that point, the die was cast, so I didn't have an impact, but I certainly made my position very clear to the party chair, the state party chair.
I also made my position clear in opposition. I didn't issue a statement. Instead, I continued to work and campaign and listen to the people of Minnesota to talk about our future and to encourage them all to participate as well.
Thank you. We are now running close to our ending time, and so we are going to ask for the closing statements from the candidates, and they will be in the opposite order of the introductory statements. So Dave Pinto, I see that he is ready.
I get to start. Oh, that's so good. That's so nice not having time to think things through. So many thanks again to the league and to my fellow candidates for running. This is hard work being a candidate, and so I'm grateful to all of them, the colleagues I've been getting to serve with, and the others as well. Many thanks to everyone else for taking the time. Again, I've been really proud of a lot of my work in this first term, and I'm really excited by the chance to go back and do more. There are a lot of opportunities that I see, and I've talked a lot about early childhood. Well, it turns out one of the best ways to help infants and kids to thrive is to help their families and communities to do that too. And so that means things like paid leave, that means affordable housing, that means safety from gun violence and action on climate change and all sorts of things. And so I'm really excited to get back to be doing that work if the voters decide to do that. And so I really appreciate you all taking the time, and please let's have the conversation continue both up until November 8th and certainly a long time, because I know that everybody in the room cares a lot about our state and about its future. So thank you again.
Thank you, everyone, for being here and participating. And I know when we're done, we'll give each other a big round of applause. It's been a really great discussion thus far. I am really honored to be here tonight to ask Minnesotans for their support and for their vote. And I am committed to working with Minnesotans across the state of Minnesota to build our future. It has been a really fantastic 2 years and my honor to serve. And we face real challenges in Minnesota when I think about the demographic changes, things like climate change and aging population, the achievement gap that we talked about earlier. Those are challenges for us and they're opportunities, but I know in my experience that we are able to tackle those things. So I think if we are willing to join together to take on the hard stuff that we face, we can build a brighter future for the people of Minnesota, all across the state of Minnesota, regardless of where you live, regardless of where you've come from. And I'm really invested and excited to take that work on. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you so much for the league for hosting this. I appreciate it.
I would also like to, again, thank the league for hosting this forum. Again, thank the audience for being here. Many of my friends came out, and I can't thank you enough for being here also. Representative Murphy has held the seat in 64A for 10 years, and I've gone door knocking in our district, and it's very clear to me she's earned the respect of many people in the district, and I give her a lot of credit for that. But what concerns me is Representative Murphy's has publicly expressed interest in a bid for governor. And that concerns me, and I think it should concern members of 64A, because I worry that the district's, the issues and the voices in our district will be left unheard. I want to be a new set of eyes in a gridlocked state legislature. I want the state needs a fresh, bold perspective. We just don't see enough Republicans in the urban Minnesota, and I want to represent 64A. I want to represent the state of Minnesota, and I hope to earn your vote. Thank you.
Amory Dively.
Well, first of all, I want to introduce my wife and my grandson that are here, over there. And second, I want to thank the League of Women Voters for providing, again, the interpreters. This is great. I like to brag that only in Minnesota is that possible. Third, I work as a pastor for a deaf church, and I also work for the Deaf, Deafblind, and Hard of Hearing Advocacy and Education. So I really appreciate knowing people here, like the people here in this table are doing fantastic work together and supporting each other. So I really appreciate your service, regardless of whether you're Democrat or Republican. I know that your heart has the best interest of Minnesotans. And I want to see that Minnesota's reputation continues to be bold. And, Minnesota has been the leader, and we're starting to become a little bit more conservative. And I think we need to take greater steps and become bold again and support the economy and growth. And that's the way that Minnesota can regain our reputation. I mean, Minnesota's always been there. Our heart and our efforts are always there. And thank you for being here together. I think, you know, you're here and we're here. Without you guys, you know, our hearts wouldn't beat. You are our heartbeat. So we're focused on you. Thank you.
Dick Cohen.
Thank you. And again, thanks to the league. Thanks for everybody being here. As Ian mentioned, I've been doing this for a while. And when I went away to school, I mentioned I went to school in Chicago at Northwestern. I thought I'd end up on the East Coast. It didn't work out. I came back here. And I've been very proud of the fact that over the years I've represented the area I grew up in, initially in the State House and now in the State Senate. And I'll tell you that I've watched, obviously, lots of legislators. And I've seen some senior legislators that when they reach that point, they kind of go through the motions. They're there for the roll calls. They're there for the committee meetings. They maybe chair a committee. But they're not really engaged. And I've told myself when I reach that point, I'm out of there. I believe I haven't reached that point. I'm still a very active legislator. A leader in the Senate, and my intent is to go back this next year, work on the issues that I've been close to, not just simply the promulgation of the state budget, but affordable housing, in terms of individual appropriations, the fact that the state grant program, the higher education grant program, has never been properly funded. I can go through a host of things that I intend to be active on, as I have been, and I think we'll continue to represent this district well. And I believe do it in a way that will be of benefit not just to Democrats, not just to people in St. Paul, but to the state of Minnesota. Appreciate your being here tonight. Hope I've earned your vote again.
Ian Baird.
Yeah, well, thank you, everyone, for coming out. And thanks to the League of Women Voters for putting this on. This has been really fun to sit here and talk about the issues and stuff. Really, what I'm about is providing opportunities to the people in St. Paul and in Minnesota at large. And I see opportunities to build a better culture for small businesses to grow and succeed, to provide school choice so that every parent and every child has the opportunity to go to the school that they choose. I believe that cutting down the bureaucracy that we see in our government is going to create more choices and more opportunities for everyone in our state to be heard directly and not just put their voice into a tin can somewhere of bureaucracy. So that's kind of really what I'm about. And I'm excited for the opportunity to break down the barriers that have formed ideologically and geographically around this area, and to provide a really fresh and new perspective for people in St. Paul. So thank you all for coming out.
Thank you very much to all of the Senate District 64 candidates who saved this evening to share their views with us. Please give them a big round of applause.